Compiler verification session. The first talk will be by David Pichardy on formal verification of a constant time-preserving C compiler. As with all speakers, we will require that he does not exceed 17 minutes, but he in particular must not take less than 17 minutes.
Okay, thank you. So hi everybody. So this talk is about compilers and a security property named constant time. I will not explain what is a compiler, but I will start explaining what is constant time programming. So it's a programming discipline to protect a program against timing side channels. So you will make sure your program do not perform secret dependent branches and memory accesses. So you have to understand where are the secrets. And it is a well-known security property for cryptographers that implements cryptographic algorithms. And it is used in very well-known cryptographic algorithms. Still, this is an error-prone security property. And you may want to use static verification tools to make sure your program is secure. So there have been several attempts to build such tools. Most of them directly verify the program at low level, at the level of the implementation, because the property is about implementation. But verifying this security property at low level is not so easy. First, you know that alias analysis, for example, is more difficult at a very low level. And if you found errors, it's more difficult to explain them to the programmer. So in a previous work with Sandrine Blasi and Alix Trieux, we provided a verification tool at source level based on the Verasco analyzer. Okay, but if you verify your program at the source level, you want to make sure your security property will be preserved by the compiler. So you need a secure compiler. So what is a secure compiler here? It's a compiler where if you start from a source program that is constant time, then the compiled program is also constant time. How do you prove that? That's the topic of this talk. But wait, if you want to prove something about a compiler, about a realistic compiler, maybe you want to use a machine check proof with a proof assistant, okay? So this is the area of verified compilers. And in this area, there is a milestone named Concert, which is a moderately optimizing compiler for C, programmed and verified in the COG proof assistant, and now being used in commercial settings and able to be being used for software certification. There is a bunch of theorems in the Concert development. They prove, for example, that the compiler will preserve memory safety. It will preserve the observable behaviors of your C programs. But the current theorems, they say nothing about side channels attacks like constant time security. Okay, so in this work, we will make precise what is cryptographic constant time for Concert, and we will provide a machine check proof that a mildly modified version of the compiler preserves cryptographic constant time. Doing that, we will explain how to turn a pre-existing formally verified compiler into a verified secure compiler, and we will provide a proof methodology for doing such thing. So first I have to give some background on Concert. Well, in Concert you have 11 languages. You start from C and you compile down to assembly. So in this work we focus on x86. So that's a lot of languages. In fact, in this work we will only consider deterministic semantics. First, because the constant time property is expressed generally with this assumption, and also because The previous verification tools that I have mentioned before, they operate at the C-sharp minor level. Verasco and the security tool based on Verasco, they operate here. So it's enough to preserve from C-sharp minor. And in fact, we will preserve from C-Lite. Okay, so still, we have 17 preservation proofs to adapt if we want to preserve this security property. Here you are in the, most of them are in the backend where you optimize your program. So, well, maybe the rest of the talk will be divided in 17 parts, but I'm not sure you will be really interested. So instead, I will give you the methodology we follow. So in Compcert, every language is given an operational semantics. It looks like that. It's a small step semantics that models a small step between a state S and a successor state S prime, and it emits a trace of external events, T. From this, you can define what is a program behavior and for a complete execution. And execution may be finite, but they may also be infinite. And in Compcert, proving behavior preservation is based on forward and backward simulation. And thanks to the determinism assumption, a forward simulation is enough. And our work is based on this technique. So what is forward simulation here? You have to introduce a simulation relation between a source state and a target state. And if S1 makes a step to S2, there must exist a sigma 2 state that is reachable after some number of steps from sigma 1 and emitting the same trace T. Sigma 2 and S2 must be in simulation relation. And maybe you are not able to step, and it's okay, but T must be empty, and there must be a decreasing measure that makes S2 lower than S1. That's because we want to preserve non-termination. Okay, that's for the background, and now we have all we need to define what is the security property for today. So, first, what we did, we extended the notion of events in the Compcert semantics with two kinds of leakages. So if you are executing a condition, you will emit the truth value of the condition in order to know if the condition was true or false. And you will also emit a leakage about pointer if you are performing a load or a store, because you want to observe that. And you may also want to observe the function pointer when you call a function. Then, with this extended semantics, you can still reason on the compile-only judgment, which is the previous Compcert semantics, just by erasing events. And you can also reason on the leak-only semantics by keeping only the leakage events. And at the end, our security property is about the behavior of this semantics. Just before defining the security property itself, we'll need to introduce a notion of indistinguishability relation between initial states. A phi relation that expresses that S and S prime share the same values for public inputs, but maybe not for secret inputs. And we say that a program is constant time with respect to phi if two initial states S and S prime that are in relation with phi, and if you consider two complete runs from S and from S prime, then they should emit the same leakages. And the main theorem we prove in Koch in this work is that in Compcert, if you start from a safe C-Lite program P, if you compile it into a x86 assembly program P prime, then if P was constant time with respect to phi, P prime is constant time. How do we prove that? Well, Comp cert is 100,000 lines of coq. So modifying the comp cert development is really a matter of proof engineering. So we spend a lot of time thinking about the methodology before starting the proof. So what we did was, okay, we have a bunch of simulation diagrams that have been already proved in comp cert. How could we reuse most of these proof scripts for this development? So what we did is that we start from the existing proofs. So here, imagine this is a diagram about the previous regular operational semantics for concert with a proof script. And in fact, we slightly modify the diagram. There are several modifications we have tried, but we make sure this modification still implies the previous standard diagram for the compile-only semantics. And this is a generic theorem. You prove it once for all, not for every languages. Then we slightly modify the previous script in order to prove the new diagram. So we reuse a lot of tactics here. And we also have a generic theorem that shows that this diagram is strong enough to enforce constant time preservation. And you prove it once for all and not for every languages. So that's our methodology. But there are not one method. There is, in fact, four methods to modify diagrams. Each of them, oops. Sorry, it doesn't count. Yes, each technique provides a specific trade-off between generality and proof tractability. So you would like to be all the time here, but it's not possible because this one is really easy to adapt. But sometimes you have to make a hard work and reason on what we call a cube, because it's about four executions. First method. This first method, well, it's a very ideal situation because you are able to prove that your transformation preserves the leakage. So if you are in this situation, it means you are able to prove the standard forward simulation diagram for the leak semantics. If you are able to prove this diagram, it's very easy to prove the preservation. Let's consider an execution at the target levels. You want to prove that tau is equal to tau prime, so you have to consider full execution here. You can exhibit source states that are also in relation with phi. Because you assume your program is safe, you can also exhibit source runs. Because the source is constant time, they should emit the same events. And because you have proved a forward simulation, tau is equal to tau prime. So this is really simple here. And we were able to use this method a number of times. I will come back to this later. But if you are not lucky, you are not able to use method one. For example, some optimizations may remove, erase leakages. And here, it is still constant time preserving as long as the decision to erase the information does not depend on secrets. So for this situation, we slightly adapt the simulation. First, we parameterize the simulation relation with a number, which should be a prediction of the number of steps at the target level. And so here you see there exists sigma 2, but you reach it with n step. And you have predicted n in the relation. And If n is equal to 0, you still have the decreasing argument. And maybe tau is equal to t, and you are in the previous situation. But maybe tau, t has been erased, and t was a Lee-Conley event. So this is the diagram of method 2. It implies the standard diagram for concert events, but it also implies constant time preservation. And indeed, it's really easy to prove this kind of diagram with existing diagrams, with existing proof scripts. You only have to modify few lines in your script. Okay, method 3, here you are really not lucky because you need a more complex diagram. For example, you may know that Comcert used the notion of memory injections for transformation where the memory layout is not preserved. And what the first consequence of that is that you will not preserve the leakage about pointers, because pointers will change during transformation. So here the diagram is a bit more complex. Now the simulation relation is also parameterized by the memory injection that is used when defining the simulation relation. And you have to explain how this memory injection is transformed. Okay. And you have to make sure that tau is a mapping of t using the memory injection. So this is a bit more complex. And but still, there is a even more complex situation when you have to use the cube. I will not explain the cube today. You have to read the paper. At the end, for 17 simulations proof, for 6 of them, we were able to use the trace preservation argument. For 5 of them, we have to use the leak erasing argument. For 5 more, we have to use the trace transformation, mainly because they were related to memory injections. And the last one need a cube. Okay, as a conclusion, we have a machine check proof of preservation. This is a slightly modified version of Comcert. You will hear about this tomorrow at the PRISC workshop. We also give a well-crafted methodology. And as further work, we would like to combine this work with verified C crypto programs and explore other observational information flow policies with their interaction with Comcert. Thank you.
Are there any questions?
Thanks very much. So to what extent does this work open the door to proving that a compiler preserves not just constant time complexity, but perhaps other time complexities, like proving that a n squared, like you know, big O n squared program is still n squared after compilation?
Yes, the framework for this proof is really constrained because you are considering two executions that are exactly at the same program point. Okay, so constant time is a really strict security property. So as soon as you will modify this property, you may encounter new problems that have not been considered here at all. So yes, this is an interesting extension, but I don't know how much we can reuse from this work. Yes, I think.
You emphasized quite a lot, which makes a lot of sense, that you try to reuse as much of Comcert's infrastructure as possible. Do you have any intuition whether, say, you don't work on Comcert, you want to actually build your own secured compiler? Is there any aspect of your approach that you would do differently if you have the choice of your approach, or is it still the right way to go anyway?
Um, I think we didn't think so much about all the options. For example, it was clear that we will follow the methodology about forward simulation, because they are everywhere in concert. And there are related work. For example, Toby Murray has been considering similar diagrams, but using backward simulations in a completely different setting and for a different compiler scheme. So here we are really focused on the forward simulation technique, and we only explore that.
It gave the impression that you were basically giving a talk on proof engineering rather than on constant time. So do you think there is this is a jump for a language about proof refactorization or proof engineering methods?
Well, proof engineering, like software engineering, is an area that is difficult to define. What is a simpler proof? What is a manageable proof? It's a bit difficult to define. In our case, for example, myself, I'm really interested in what are the methodologies that will make my script more robust, more easy to adapt, but I don't have a right metric for that. So I'm not ready yet to have a language also for that. Yes.
All right. Let's thank the speaker again.